And all that stuff look like. stuff.
I
especially our church, for we need to know what it means to be a Christian. We need to know what the Bible says regarding our salvation. And so when we finish off our subject matter, we dive in right in. I can't wait to get to that. I'm chomping at the bit to get to that subject matter. But let's go ahead and finish our series from the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 6. All we're about to say, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. When you read the Gospels, Jesus spoke quite often of the kingdom of God. And as a child of God, there are an array of forces that have been levied against you. And allow me to repeat what I said last week. That wants to derail you at best, destroy you at worst. But know that every attack that you receive as a child of God is not really against you. It's against your faith. You see, Satan wants you to quit believing. And he will stop him. To see to it. He destroys your faith. Ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, many Christians today do not understand spiritual warfare. Comprehend that they are up against. And at the same time, they do not understand that there is a real enemy out to get you. We're not talking about a boogeyman. We're not talking about a werewolf or any fictitious creature. We're talking about a powerful entity that wants to see you in. So the scripture says that he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Just to give us a glimpse, just a little bit on what spiritual warfare really is. There's a whole litany of information. But I believe that we can sum it up into this one short definition. And it's this. It's the ongoing conflict against us, the human race, from its enemies, the world of affliction, for the purposes of keeping non-believers from ever having a relationship with Christ and rendering the Christian non-believing. Did you hear that? The devil wants to render you useless. Because if you're useless, then guess what? What good are you to the kingdom of God? He knows that every single child of God is a threat. You are a threat of darkness. No, church, you're not getting it. I understand some of us have different personalities. Some of us are quiet. Some of us are reserved. Some of us are loud. Some of us can be obnoxiously loud. But regardless of your personality, you've got to understand that as a child of God, you are a direct threat. As a result of Satan himself wants to destroyed. You have a threat. Satan sees you as a threat. So he's trying to accomplish you. Anybody get one? Destroy you. He did not just have a mission. But he taught me trials come against you. So you have to understand, number one, who and what we are up against. In my preparation for this message, John Stott, in his writings and his commentary on the book of Ephesians, wrote this down, and he said this. He said there are three things you need to know about your enemy. Now let's stop for a second before I get into the three steps. These three things. Y'all need to understand something. Satan is not God's enemy. God has no enemy. He has no evil. He has no life. God's the creator. God is the creator. Satan is nothing.
Instruction.
then you have the last but not least, spirit of your weakness, demons and spirit. You speak what you're wanting, then it's written. You have Satan, but you have his word. You have power. The darkness in this world is spiritual. When he says, in other words, these rank and file of Satan's kingdom are an extremely brutal and powerful force. Then it just stops there. Not only are they powerful, they are wicked. Think about this for a second. From the headquarters of evil and hazards. We need to know that this wicked enemy has no moral principles, no code of honor, no higher feelings. They're utterly unscrupulous and ruthless in their pursuit of their malicious design. In other words, they do not abide by the Geneva Convention.
Sure.
is a child of God. Yes, you do have an enemy that is coming against you. But God will not leave you.
We would be looking at this and saying that makes absolutely no sense whatsoever.
Because our soldiers look differently. They dress differently. But back in that timeline, he's used it. And Roman soldiers are something just like a Roman soldier. And he begins to explain and express what this soldier would wear. And he begins with the belt. What is the purpose of a belt? Well, how many of you know? Back in the time in their tunic when they were getting ready to fight, if there was nothing to secure their outfit, then before their outfit would be flailing around everywhere and it would hinder the movement. Think about it today. If you don't wear a belt, I saw a video and it was the funniest thing I'd ever seen. It was the most absolute funniest thing I'd ever seen. There was a guy, and he was on the street, and he had his Jeep down here. And he's walking around, and somebody honked his horn and called him a name. And he started off, and the guy started to run. But as he started to run, his pants hit the floor, and he went face first into the concrete. In a type of you've got to be prepared.
Yeah.
You are in war, ladies and gentlemen. You are in a battle, and you need to be prepared. And the first thing he talks about is the belt of truth. What is truth? Let's just refer to this for a second. I should say what, but who is truth? Come on, church. Who is truth? Jesus. Shod with the preference of the gospel, In other words, you gotta have the right boots on.